أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي ليس لأوليته ابتداء ولا لأزليته انقضاء، وانحصرت الأوصاف عن كنه معرفته ورضعت عظمته العقول، والذي لا تواري عنه سماء سماء ولا أرض أرضا. ثم الصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على سيد البطحاء سيد المرسلين والأنبياء أبي القاسم محمد المصطفى. وعلى الجوهرة القدسية البتول العذراء سيدة النساء فاطمة الزهراء، وعلى بعلها أمير المؤمنين وبنيها الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. لا سيما على بقية الله وحجته الكبرى الذي بيمنه رزق الورى وبوجوده ثبتت الأرض والسماء، ولولاه لصاخت الأرض بأهلها، واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم أجمعين من حين عداوتهم إلى قيام يوم الدين. We were discussing about the tafsir, the أقوال in the tafsir of حروف المقطعات of the Holy Quran. And in the previous lesson, we talked about the first and the second, and we probably touched the third qawl and third statement of the Mufassireen about the al-huruf al-muqatta'ah. If you recall, the second qawl that we discussed was the qawl of Ayatullah al-Uzma, Sheikh Abu Ja'far al-Tusi rahmatullah alayhi, in his Tafsir Kitab al-Tibyan, Tafsir al-Tibyan. And he had said that Huruf al-Muqatta'at are the names of those surahs. So in 29 surahs of Quran, we have the Huruf al-Muqatta'at, and surahs have various names. And one of the names of these surahs were the Huruf al-Muqatta'ah is mentioned, that's the name of that surah. So my teacher Ayatullah Jawadi Amuli Hafadahullah, in his tafsir, Tafsir al-Tasneem, tafsir, this tafsir is a remarkable tafsir, not just because he's my teacher, but as a matter of fact, because he's the student of Allama al-Tabatabai rahmatullah alayh, and obviously he studied his tafsir, he studied from Allama al-Tabatabai, who wrote the Tafsir al-Mizan. And when he's writing a new tafsir after the Tafsir al-Mizan, obviously it has something more than the Tafsir al-Mizan. If it is the same thing, there's no use of writing the mukarrarat, the repeated stuff, isn't it right? So obviously Tafsir of Tasneem has way more information than you can find in Tafsir al-Mizan. And this is his, I would say, in my haqir opinion, his irfani perspective of his personality, that he has named his tafsir with Tasneem, because that's the Tasneem ashrafu sharabin fil jannah, isn't it right? Yashrabuhu Muhammadun wa ala Muhammadin alayhi salatu wa salam wa yumzaju li ashabil yameen. And this is a very beautiful discussion, that how many fountains are there in the paradise, but the most superior of all the fountains inside the jannat, the paradise, the most superior fountain is called Tasneem, and that is Mukhtas and exclusively and specifically for the Prophet and Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam and those who are counted to be part of Ahlul Bayt. So this is وَيُمْزَجُ لِأَصْحَابِ الْيَمِينِ and it will be mixed. That means few drops of the fountain of Tasneem will be added for the Abrar and the Salihin. The rest of the good doers who are the dwellers of Jannat and Paradise, they will only get the drink which is mixed and makhloot and mashub and mixed up with few drops of Tasneem. So this naming of his tafsir itself shows that he has the Irfani perspective and lataif and isharat. Alhamdulillah. So he, my teacher rejected the statement of Sheikh Abu Ja'far al-Tusi rahmatullah alayhi by saying that there is no dalil for us to believe that the huruf al-muqatta'at in the beginning of the surah are the names of that surah. We don't have any dalil shar'i or aqli, you know, for that. Now the third tafsir in the aqwal which we are inshallah intending to mention in these nights, 20 of those aqwal of tafsir about that. The third one is the statement which says that huruf al-muqatta'at are basically the name of the Holy Quran itself. Not the name of the surahs like Sheikh Ja'far, Abu Ja'far al-Tusi rahmatullah alayhi has said, but the names of Quran. Just like Quran has a zikr, just like the name of the Quran is, for example, Al-Furqan. Similarly, one of the names of the Quran are these Hurufun Muqatta'at. Well, again, this claim is not supported by any Dalil or Burhan and is not accepted. And according to this tafsir, wherever there is Hurufun Muqatta'at mentioned, it will be ja'iz, it will be acceptable in terms of the meaning to put the word Quran in place of that. So in Surah Maryam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kaf ha ya ayn sad, dhikru rahmat rabbika abduhu zakariya. So it will be correct, according to this call, to put the name Al Quran instead of that. Huruf al-muqatta'at. So somebody can say Al-Quran Dhikru Rahmat Rabbika Abdahu Zakariya. According to the call, this would have been correct, but since we don't have any dalil to support this statement, it is also not accepted. The fourth tafsir about huruf al-muqatta'at is that these huruf are like rams. They are like secret codes and ishara and indicators towards one of the names among the beautiful names, Al-Asma'ul Husna, beautiful names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and ishara towards the name of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. So according to this call in tafsir, Allah is pointing towards some of his beautiful names, Al-Asma'ul Husna, or some of the names of the Prophet, like Yasin, isn't it right? Or Taha, relating to the Prophet. So this statement says, this call of the Mufassirin says that basically Huruf and Muqatta'at are taken from some of the names of Allah. That means, let's suppose the word Allah is taken and you take the Hamza from the word Allah, and then Lam, Alif Lam Mim, for example. So Lam you can take from the word Ar-Rahman, and Mim you can take from the word Alim, for example, Al-Alim. And this is how some of the words are combined in form of huruf al-muqatta'at, and they are taken from various names, al-asma'ul husna, the various beautiful names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So like meme is common in so many of the names, Ali, Al-Alim, Al-Hakim, Al-Rahim, and so on and so forth, isn't it right? So this is how they are saying that various letters of the various names, beautiful names of Allah, are taken and then combined together in Huruf al-Muqatta'at, and now these Huruf al-Muqatta'at are serving as secrets and rums for the names of Allah and the name of the Prophet. And then they use the shi'r from the Arabic adab and literature. Arabs in the times of Jahiliyyah had the command in the Arabic language. You know, you need to accept, even if there's something from the enemies, you have to accept it, isn't it right? Even those people were mushrik and kafir and idol worshippers, and they are not our friends, but we have to accept. What is good has to be accepted. The good thing about them is that they had great command over their language, you know, and the ash'ar of Jahiliyyat are taught in every hausa, every Shia hausa of Islam today. Sab' al-Mu'allaqat or Ashr al-Mu'allaqat, the seven famous qasidas of those ash'ar, shu'ara of Jahiliyyat, who used to come and gather once in a year at the Kaaba where their idols were located, and everyone is there and they recited their ash'ar. And so many of the people were reciting the ash'ar, you know, all of a sudden, without preparing in their homes, just stand there and start saying the shi'r. How can you find people on that level of balaghat, of the lughat, that they can say the shi'r, such a beautiful Arabic shi'r, you know, all of a sudden? You know, you invite somebody on the microphone and you ask them, okay, now start saying a qasida. Isn't that difficult? Especially in a language like Arabic, which is the deepest language. And not just saying a qasida, but saying a beautiful qasida in terms of the Arabic grammar, beautiful, not in terms of the Islamic values. We don't agree with them. They are kuffar. But in terms of the Arabic grammar, it was beautiful and eloquent. And that's why it's part of the nisab of the hausa. And we study, in every hausa, we study the ash'ar of Jahiliyyat and ash'ar of Mutanabbi, and likewise sab'ul mu'allaqat, for example. So those seven famous qasidas which were hanging at the Holy Kaaba, and that used to be a pride and fakhr for the entire qabila for the rest of the year, that the sha'ir belonging to this qabila, his shay was accepted in the competition. So the ash'ar are frequently, if you study the Arabic grammar, every now and then the writer of a book of Arabic grammar will be mentioning the ash'ar of Arabic language from the time of Jahiliyyat. Unfortunately, not today's times. Today you find very, very few people who can bring shi'r like the kuffar of Jahiliyyat. But in those days, like I said, we must accept that they were at the very high level of balaghat. So in this qawl in the tafsir also have brought shi'r. I will not read the complete shi'r because it's makruh to recite the shi'r in the fasting, except if it is for the madh of the Prophet and Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. So this is not for the madh of them. So I've just will read one misra, not the complete shi'r. And that's what these mufassireen, these people have said, that the sha'ir says, قُلْنَ لَهَا قِفِي قَالَتْ قَاف. So this misra of the shi'r has been brought as an evidence in the tafsir. They see the sha'ir is using the rams and the code instead of using the whole word, you know, instead of using the complete word of Arabic. قَدْ وَقَفْتُ. Instead of قَدْ وَقَفْتُ, that I did stop, the sha'ir just says the word qaf. So this is how the rams has been used in the shi'r. And also they have brought a hadith as their evidence according to this narration. You know, in one of the hadith it says, according to this naql, كَفَى بِالسَّيْفِ شَاء. So the Sha word has been used as a rams towards the word Shafiyan. That means that's to give the cure. And the sword is enough to give the cure. So this is how they have been furnishing their call with these kinds of evidences. And also Sheikh al-Ra'is Abu Ali Sina rahmatullahi alayh, his name was corrupted with the West to Avicenna, isn't it right? He's one of the great scholars of Islam, Shia scholar Sheikh al-Ra'is Abu Ali Sina, and his qabr is located in the city of Hamadan in Iran. So he was a great Iranian scholar whose books have been taught for centuries in Cordoba, Spain, and in the Muslim Spain for centuries, when the Europe was drowned in the darkness of ignorance. So Abu Ali Sina's books were taught, like Shifa, Kitab al-Shifa, was taught for centuries without any updating. No one can dare update the books written by him about medicine. It was so updated, it didn't require any amendments. So Abu Ali Sina rahmatullah alayh, in his Risalatul Nawruziyya, says a statement which is quite similar to this call of tafsir, where he says this: these huruf are the rams, and basically alif is nazar, it's an ishara. Alif is an ishara towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and ba is the ishara towards al-aql al-awwal, and jeen is the ishara towards nafsun kulliyah, and dal, for example, in Arabic language is the ishara towards alamut tabi'a, and so on and so forth. This is like how Abu Ali Sina is mentioning in his tafsir, so which is quite similar to this call of tafsir that we are talking about. And also Muhaqqiq Kashani in his tafsir is saying, which his tafsir is called Ta'wilat. Ta'wilat is in the tafsir of Quran. You know, tafsir al-Quran al-Kareem, which is commonly known to be the tafsir of Ibn Arabi, but actually it is not the tafsir of Ibn Arabi, it is the tafsir of Muhaqqiq Kashani. So Muhaqqiq Kashani in his tafsir says that the huruf of alif ba are basically, these are ishara and indications towards alif stands for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is awwal, he is the first, and lam is the ishara towards al-aql al-fa'al, the active intellect, which the philosophers call to Jibreel, Sayyid al-Malaika, and meen is the ishara towards Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Through him the universe is reconnected. He comes, Prophet is going to come at the end, and at the end he's going to reconnect and rejoin the universe with the origin, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is how Muhaqqiq Kashani have been talking about in his Ta'wilat. Now this is also something which is not accepted, because the narrations which are mentioned, some of those narrations which are mentioned are either Mursala, and Riwayatun Mursala is not authentic and acceptable in Ilm al-Hadith. And some of the narrations have their Dalalat al-Da'if, so it's not accepted either. And so basically the only thing left for their Dalil is the Shi'r of Arabic, which they have mentioned. The riwayat do not stand any credible status. So the shi'r which is mentioned is also not considered to be a dalil, my teacher says, because in shi'r it is several things are allowed. When you are saying a shi'r, we have zaruratun shi'riya, zarurat shi'ri, how we say in Farsi, isn't it right? According to the zarurat shi'ri, it is allowed to do several things which are not allowed in the nasr, in the prose. So you, certain things are allowed in the poetry, but not allowed in the prose. So basically, my teacher says, we don't have any evidence in the prose, in the Nasr. We don't have any evidence in the Arabic language, in the entire prose of Arabic, that rums and rumus are used as ishara towards the word. You don't find any evidence in the Arabic language for that. So any usage in the shi'r is not the dalil, because in shi'r it is daruratun shi'riya. Zarurat shi'ri, which is allowed in the shi'r, and that you can drop the things, you can add the huruf, and so on and so forth. So likewise, my teacher says the call of Shaykh al-Ra'is Abu Ali Sina rahmatullah alayhi, that alif and the abjad of Arabic is standing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, my teacher said that's also not acceptable, because you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's awwaliyat doesn't depend on the Arabic language. Isn't it right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was awwal before everything else. And the language is amrun i'tibari, is something that the wadi, the person or the people or the group of people who create a language, they take certain word in their mind and they take certain ma'na, certain meaning in their mind, and they assign this word for this meaning. So this is called i'tibar. So this is called, you know, they are assigning this word or these alphabets for that meaning. So because the wadi'een, because the creators of the language assign certain words for certain meanings, you know, doesn't mean that that word stands for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is haqiqatun takwiniyya. Allah is a reality of the real world. Whereas the language is not the reality of the real world. Language is haqiqatun i'tibariyya. There's a huge difference between haqiqatun i'tibariyya and haqiqatun takwiniyya. So you cannot consider something which is related to the creator of the language at the time he's assigning the words for certain meanings. You take his i'tibar and the way he takes the words for specific meanings. You cannot use that for something which is real of the real world. So this is also unacceptable to say that the huruf in the Arabic alphabet stands for those meanings. And also Allama At-Tabatabai rahmatullah alayh, he says in his Tafsir Al-Mizan volume 18, he says, let me first say his statement first for those of you who can understand Farsi. Istifade as rams, the jais ke guyande nimi khahat juz mukhatab kisi be murad u pay be barad. You use, Allama Tabatabai says in his Tafsir al-Mizan, that we use the coding, codes and rumus are used in a place where the speaker does not want the mukhatab, the audience, to understand. So there are codes used, so only those who deserve will understand. Not everybody else will not understand. That's why we use the codes. Is that right? So the mutakallim, the speaker, does not want every mukhatab, every person in the audience, to understand the meaning. So only this intended people. Whereas Allah Ta'ala says in Mizan, the Asma al-Husna, the beautiful names of Allah, 99 beautiful names of Allah, are all tasrihan. The names of Allah are tasrihan or talwihan, clearly mentioned in the Holy Quran, or indicated towards in the Holy Quran. So when the names are not a hidden information, it's a public information, even a non-Muslim can pick up the Holy Quran and find out the Al-Asma al-Husna, the beautiful names. It's not a hidden information, isn't it right? So you can find the translation of Quran, the text of Quran on Google, isn't it right? It's accessible for everybody, Muslim or non-Muslim. So beautiful names, Al-Asma'ul Husna, is not a hidden information that requires rams to be used by the mutakallim so some people can understand and the rest cannot understand. Names of Allah, everybody knows it. It's not hidden for anybody. Isn't it right? Anybody who wants to learn, he can find it, and it's clearly or indicated towards in the Holy Quran. So there is no, when that's the case, when the beautiful names are already mentioned in the Quran, it doesn't leave any room for a person to say that these codes are used so only some people can understand and rest of the muhatab, rest of the audience cannot discover. It doesn't leave any room for a person to say that kind of statement. So this fourth statement in the tafsir is also not acceptable. Now going to the fifth tafsir of Huruf al-Muqatta'ah is that fifth call says that Huruf al-Muqatta'ah are actually the parts of al-Ismul A'zam al-Ilahi, the greatest name of Allah. These huruf are scattered in the form of huruf al-muqatta'at, and if you combine those scattered huruf, we can do the tartib, we can compose the al-ismul a'zam, the greatest name of Allah, through these scattered huruf. This is what the call of the tafsir says. So we know that al-ismul azam, the greatest name of Allah, is something which we can use for tasarruf in alam al-takween. You can do miracles and mu'jiza. If somebody knows al-ismul azam, the greatest name of Allah, he can do whatever he wants. Right? It's a blank check for him. He can do anything what he wants. Anything absolutely what he likes to do, depending on how much he knows. So obviously they are darajat. So if you are on the highest level, you can do everything. You are on the lower level, you can do few things or some of the things. So, but basically you can do tasarruf. You can utilize the existences around you and do things. And you can do tayyul arv. You know, the earth gets squeezed up and you can move around faster. So all those things are related to the ism al-azam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these huruf, the qawl and the tafsir says these huruf are scattered in the huruf al-muqatta'at. We need to combine and discover the ism al-azam from that. So for example, alif lam ra is taken, and ha meem is taken, and noon wal qalam. So noon is taken and we combine it together to form ar-Rahman, which is obviously ism al-a'zam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So huruf al-muqatta'at are indicating, so basically they are scattered, we need to combine them. Well, this call is also, my teacher says, this is also not acceptable as the tafsir of huruf al-muqatta'at. First of all, al-ism al-a'zam of Allah is not a hidden name. First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's greatest name is Allah. It's not hidden on even a kafir. And the second greatest name is ar-Rahman, which is also not hidden on any kafir or a Muslim, right? So these are the two greatest names of Allah. So every other name of Allah is under the umbrella of these two. So Allah has countless names. فِي كُلِّ شَيْءٍ لَهُ آيَةٌ تَدُلُّ عَلَىٰ أَنَّهُ وَاحِدٌ. Isn't it right? فِي كُلِّ تَحْرِيكَةٍ وَتَسْكِينَةٍ لَهُ شَاهِدٌ. In everything there is an ayat that guides us towards Allah who is wahid and one and alone. And in every movement and stationary existence is a guidance for us to discover that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there and He is one. So every particle of the universe is the ayat of Allah, is a sign of God. You know, it requires the vision to understand. So everything is a sign of God, an ayat of Allah, is ayatullah. Everything is an ayatullah in the literal meaning of the word. Obviously right now the istilah of ayatullah is used in other times, other terminologies for a mujtahid who is mutlaq in his ijtihad. So we have two kinds of ijtihad. Al-ijtihad, bit-tajazzi, and al-ijtihad al-itlaq. الاجتهاد بالتجزي means المجتهد المتجزي means a person who has done اجتهاد in some of the chapters of the fiqh or some of the parts of the chapters of the fiqh. So everyone who studies the Bahth al-Kharij, Dars al-Kharij, almost everyone who is not wasting his time and studying it properly is a mujtahid who is mutajazzi. Partially, he is a mujtahid. But that's not significant. What is significant if a person becomes al-mujtahid al-itlaq. That means he is comprehensive ijtihad. He can extract all the ahkam of the sharia, of all the 200 plus chapters of our fiqh, directly from the sources which are Quran and Sunnah of Prophet and Ahlul Bayt and Ijma' and Aql and Al-Usul Al-Amaliyya, Al-Adilla Ghair Al-Muhriza, Al-Adilla Al-Muhriza and Al-Adilla Ghair Al-Muhriza. So person who has comprehensive command to extract and derive all the ahkam directly from the manabi' al-ijtihad, from the sources of ijtihad in all the chapters without exception, is called mujtahid al-mutlaq. Have an absolute ijtihad, and upon that kind of person, taqleed is not jaiz. He cannot do the taqleed of anyone. He has to follow his own fatwa and ra'i. So we find that ismi a'zam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Allah and Ar-Rahman. The rest of the names of Allah are all under the umbrella of these two great names. So, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Ash-Shafi, the one who provides the cure. Everyone who gets the cure and shifa, it's from Allah, no one else. Isn't it right? Who is Shafi? He's the only one who is Shafi. تقديم ما حقه التأخير يفيد الحصر. Isn't it right? So when we say هو الشافي, it means he is the only one who cures. No one else cures. This is also part of shirk. And some people end up saying, if this doctor was not there, I would have died in the hospital. If anyone says this kind of statement by ignoring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has done shirk. وما يؤمن أكثرهم بالله إلا وهم مشركون. And the tafsir has been, in the tafsir has been mentioned, you know, this example. Then our mufassirin say, if a person, let's suppose, talks about a doctor, if this doctor was not there to provide me the cure on time, I would have been dead by ignoring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you are bringing the doctor in the middle, the doctor is the one who gave me shifa. This is nothing but shirk. Every mu'min is a mushrik, except very few. Because this kind of shirk is used, you know, frequently by some people. So what we say is that Shafi is only Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name is Shafi. This is not al-ism al-a'zam. That's not the greatest name of Allah. This is an ism al-azim, a great name, not the greatest. This is Ismun Azim, not Ismun A'zam. Shafi is Ismun Azim. Why? Because Shafi is under the umbrella of Ism Ar-Raziq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah gives the shifa because Allah is Raziq. Who else is supposed to give the shifa other than the one who is Raziq? So Allah is Ar-Raziq, the sustainer. This is not Ismun A'zam. This is again another Ismun Azim, a great name, not the greatest name of Allah. Because Ar-Raziq is falling under the umbrella of another name of Allah, which is Al-Qadir, Al-Khaliq, I'm sorry, Al-Khaliq. Isn't that right? So because Allah is the creator, because Allah creates, He has to provide the rizq. For every makhluk, there is a rizq, including shaitan. Isn't that right? ما من مخلوق إلا وقد جعلت له رزقا فما رزقي يا رب. Then shaitan said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for every creation you provided a risk, what is my risk? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to that riwayat, replied back, ما لم يذكر عليه اسمي. That means anything upon which my name is not mentioned. So our religion Islam teaches us, when you start eating the food or the drink, you say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. That's how shaitan is not a sharik in the food. If you ignore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, the angels come and say, angels say to shaitan, udno ya fasiq. Get closer, O fasiq. Shaitan starts eating from that food. So basically, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is raziq, sustainer, because he's the khaliq. So the name ar-raziq is not ismun a'zam, it's ismun azim, under another name's umbrella, which is al-khaliq. So al-shafi is not ismun a'zam, is not the greatest name of Allah, it's ismun azim. This is under another name, which is ar-raziq. This is also not ismun a'zam, this is also azim, a great name, because ar-raziq is under another name, which is al-khaliq, the creator. So Allah is giving shifa because he is giving the risk. He is giving the risk because he is the creator. Who else should give the risk other than the creator? Now Allah is the khaliq. Not, this is also not the ismun a'zam, the greatest name of Allah. This is ismun azim, because that's under another name of Allah, which is al-qadir. And al-qadir relates to the qudrat of Allah, the strength and power of God, which is ainu dhat, which is nothing but his essence. Now we have sifatul af'al of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, certain attributes which are related to his actions. When we have sifatul dhat, isn't it right? The sifat which are ainu dhat, which are nothing but his essence. So sifatul af'al are not ainu dhat. Allah, any sifat, he is called, he is muttasif, he is assigned with that sifat after he performs the action. Not before he performs the action. So Allah is named with the sifat which is related to the fa'il and action, sifatul fa'il, when he performs. So Allah will be called shafi when he gives the shifa. Allah will be called raziq when he starts giving the risk. Allah will be called khaliq when he started to create. Is that right? That's not ayn al-zat. But Allah is called Qadir since ever and forever, regardless of he creating or not creating, giving risk or not giving risk, providing shifa or not providing shifa. Because Qudrat of Allah is ayn al-zat. Just like the ilm and hayat and irada. So we find that Al-Qadir is another great name of Allah, but that is not the Ismun A'zam. This is still not the greatest name, because Al-Qadir includes only one aspect of Allah, which is his Qudrat, not the rest of the Sifat. Allah has a lot of Sifat, isn't that right? When you talk about Al-Qadir, Huwa Al-Qadir, Ya Qadir, you are mentioning one sifat in your nazar, in your eyes, you're focusing on one attribute only. You are not taking into consideration all the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Al-Qadir is ayn al-dhat, but it's not ismun a'zam. So unless and until you come and say the word Allah or Ar-Rahman, you have not mentioned all the attributes and sifat, because Allah is defined as al-ismul jami' al-mustajmi' li-jami' sifat al-kamaliyya, that name which is encompassing and engulfs all the perfect attributes together. So when we say Allah, it includes every sifat in it. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name Allah is ismun a'zam. Now the Holy Quran has said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the, I think we are getting closer to the Adhan time. So inshallah, we will continue that inshallah later on. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma ansur al-Islam wa al-Muslimin. واخذل الكفار والمنافقين اللهم انصر من نصر الدين واخذل من خذل المسلمين اللهم انصر واحفظ وأيد علماءنا الربانيين ومراجعنا الربانيين، لا سيما الولي الفقيه قائد المسلمين. اللهم انصر جيوش المسلمين وعساكر الموحدين. اللهم فك عن الأسراء المسلمين. اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى، وعجل في فرج مولانا صاحب الزمان، واجعلنا من أنصاره وأشياعه وأتباعه وأعوانه بجاه محمد وآله الطاهرين.